Which of the following looks better to you? This gray plate of boiled meat?
Ew, gross.
Or this perfectly seared golden brown pork chop? I think we can all agree there's a world of difference between these plates. This one just looks so much better. And it's not just about how it looks either. This golden piece of seared pork chop is gonna taste so much better as well. And in this video, I'm gonna teach you the science of why that is. So to understand this browning a little better, I'm gonna take you on a quick history lesson back to 1912, when French researcher Louis-Camille Maillard made a discovery that changed our understanding of the way food cooks. He discovered that when food is heated to certain temperatures, the proteins and sugars in that food begin to kind of fuse together, creating a bunch of new molecules and new flavor compounds. And as a result, your food begins to brown and it takes on all these new flavors and aromas that weren't there before. We now call this process the Maillard reaction, and it's responsible for all sorts of delights, such as that perfect sear on a steak, the golden skin on roasted vegetables, the beautiful brown crust bread gets when it's baking in the oven, and that incredible smell and aroma that coffee beans develop when they're roasted. Though we refer to it as the Maillard reaction, it's actually a whole bunch of reactions that all happen together at the same time when food is heated to at least 140 degrees Celsius. And while we still don't really understand these reactions all that well, what we do know is that they can create hundreds of new flavor compounds, meaning just by heating your food up to 140 degrees Celsius, you are literally making it hundreds of times more delicious. Understanding how the Maillard reaction works is probably one of the single biggest things you can do to improve your home cooking, because it allows you to break free from just following recipes step by step and instead allows you to use the science to improv as you go. Luckily, it's also really simple to understand. The basic formula is sugar, which often takes the form of carbs, plus protein, plus heat, equals flavor.
I'm going to flavor town.
This formula explains so many things, like why you should add honey or sugar to your marinades. The extra sugar will fuse with your proteins, creating a more delicious golden brown sear. It explains why pastries often brush with egg. The extra protein fuels the reaction, creating a darker golden brown crust. And it explains why a fried egg cooked in your sizzling hot pan will take on a brown crust, while an egg boiled in water will never brown because it never reaches past 140 degrees. You can use this formula to brown pretty much any food that contains both proteins as well as sugars, which happens to be pretty much most foods. Things like meats, nuts, cereals, fungi, and most vegetables are all particularly great contenders for browning. And the different proteins and sugars in these foods will produce distinctly different aromas, which is why roasting vegetables smells so different to a searing pork chop, which smells entirely different to a loaf of baking bread. The Maillard reaction is easy to understand, but it's also surprisingly easy to screw up. There's two ways that people generally tend to get this wrong. The most dramatic way to screw this up is to allow your food to get too hot, or in other words, burnt. Remember how in the formula, sugar plus protein plus heat equals flavor, so surely that means that adding more heat equals more flavor, right? Well, that is true, but only up to a certain point. The more heat you apply to your food, the more energy there is that can go into fusing those sugars and proteins together, and the faster the Maillard reaction will occur. So for example, at 150 degrees, your food will actually brown twice as fast as it would at 140 degrees Celsius. But as with so many things in life, you can have too much of a good thing, and so it is with heat. If you use too high a heat source, or you just don't take your food off the heat quick enough, your food will very quickly go from that perfect Maillard temperature zone of 140 degrees Celsius up to the scorched food zone of 180 degrees plus. Basically, at this point, your food will go from perfectly brown to burned and black and bitter, and basically, you're gonna know when this happens because your food is gonna smell burnt, it's gonna taste burnt, it's gonna be ruined, and you're not gonna make that same mistake twice. The more common but less obvious way to screw this up is not allowing your food to get hot enough. This is what's happening when your food just turns out a little gray and sad and just never takes on that beautiful golden brown sear. And the culprit in this case is usually water in the pan. And no, I'm not talking about dunking your food in water like this. Usually just a tiny amount of water can be enough to ruin that sear. To understand why, let's take a quick look at the science again. At atmospheric pressure, it's physically impossible for water to heat up past 100 degrees Celsius. And if you don't believe me, you can try this out yourself. Just get a pot of water to boil on your stove and use a thermometer, and you'll see that as soon as the temperature hits plus or minus 100 degrees, it will stop rising, even if you crank the stove up to maximum heat. Past 100 degrees, all excess energy goes not into heating the water, but into evaporating it into steam, which can get a lot hotter than 100 degrees Celsius. So when you have water in your pan, your food basically gets stuck at 100 degrees and it can never reach those 140 required for the Maillard reaction to take place, at least not until all of the water has evaporated first. The proteins in your food will still cook, which is why meat will turn gray when it's boiled, but they'll never brown. You're essentially boiling or steaming your food at this point. The thing is, it's obvious that there's water in our pan if we're making something like a soup or a stew, but a lot of the times we get water in there without even realizing it. There's a lot of reasons this can happen, but let's take a quick look at how to avoid the most common mistakes. Number one, pat your ingredients dry before placing them in the pan. If your food is damp or even just a little bit wet around the outside, remember your food is just gonna get stuck at 100 degrees Celsius until all that water has evaporated, and by the time it reaches a temperature where it can start browning, your food will probably have overcooked, be dry, or just not that nice. Number two, don't crowd your pan. The more food you have in your pan, the more energy will be required to heat everything up to 140 degrees and evaporate all that water. Number three, buy better quality meat. Now this is a bit of a weird one if you don't know this already, but basically a lot of supermarket meat has water injected into it. It sounds really gross and it is kind of gross, but it's a real thing. You can look this up. Basically by injecting it with like thousands of little needles and then pumping it full of water, they make the meat look plumper and basically way more than it actually does, making you think you're getting a better deal. The problem is all of this water will come back out of your meat when it's heated, flooding your pan and ruining your sear. The solution is simple, buy better quality meat. See if you can find a local butcher, or in a lot of countries, new companies are popping up that basically allow you to buy ethically raised, high quality meat that hasn't been pumped full of water or antibiotics, and they'll ship it straight to your door. And as a bonus, this meat generally tends to be tastier as well. Number four, add a splash of oil or fat to your pan. Unlike water, oil can actually heat up well past 100 degrees before it begins to evaporate. Also, it heats up about twice as fast as water and it's very effective at coating your food. If you were to look at your food at a microscopic level, you'd see that the surface is rarely perfectly flat. Different types of materials have different textures and different grooves, and also your food rarely lays flat on the pan itself. It usually has some sort of grooves and ridges, and that's where oil and fat are perfect at getting inside all those little nooks and crannies, basically acting as a heat transfer medium and making sure that a much greater surface area of your food is being directly heated by your pan. Number five. If you want browning to occur, do not fry your food at the same time as veggies that release a bunch of water. Throwing things like mushrooms or bok choy or spinach into your pan followed by meat will just result in a bunch of disappointment as those veggies will release all their water, flooding your pan and making sure that your meat never browns and instead boils. So if you are cooking with these kinds of vegetables, make sure to brown your protein first, take it out of the pan, then cook those veggies, and finally add the protein back in at the end once everything is nicely cooked. So what do we do if we want to cook something watery like a soup or a stew, but we still want all of that flavor from the Maillard reaction? Is it possible to get the best of both worlds? The key is to brown your food before adding liquids. This is why you should sear your meat if you're making a stew, and why it's also a good idea to roast or fry your vegetables before making a stock. By starting with a dry cooking method, we first create all that flavor and then we add the liquid, which will then dissolve and infuse all of that flavor from the Maillard reaction. All right, so the next time you cook, keep this formula in mind and ask yourself these three questions. Number one, if you're cooking proteins, is there any way to add more carbs or sugar to fuel that reaction, for example, in the form of something like a marinade? Number two, if you're cooking sugary foods or carbs, is there any way to add more protein to the reaction, for example, the form of dairy like milk or cream? And number three, is your food actually getting hot enough, or is water getting in the way of browning? Of course, you don't need the Maillard reaction in everything you cook, but you'll be pretty surprised at just how many recipes this is a crucial step in. And if you want even tastier food, make sure to check out this playlist, which has a bunch more tips and tricks to level up your home cooking. Don't forget to subscribe. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.